again, my name is Katie. I'm going to be the moderator for today's panel, and I'd like to introduce our two panelists who are here to share their expertise with you. So to my right, we have Celeste Hoeg. Celeste is the principal of the Pacheco Elementary School in New Bedford, and I'm going to read their bios to give you a little background. So while within the Brockton Public Schools for almost 15 years, Celeste was a middle school English as well as a second, or excuse me, English as a second language teacher, a district-wide elementary literacy coach, an elementary school reading specialist, and then an associate principal for curriculum and instruction. Celeste is currently an elementary school principal in New Bedford and also a doctoral candidate at Northeastern University. So thank you for being here, Celeste.
And I'm an alum.
And an alum?
Yes.
What year?
I did my CAGS in reading here. Great program. So with Dr. Farr.
Awesome. Thank you, Celeste.
Yep.
And our other panelist is Heidi Driscoll. So Heidi is currently the Director of Academics at Southeastern Regional Vocational Technical School District. Since she has served in this role since 2008, she leads initiatives to increase student achievement and success. Heidi is a triple alum of BSU, receiving her Bachelor's and Master of Arts in English, along with her CAGS, her Certificate of Advanced Graduate Studies in Educational Leadership. Prior to working at Southeastern Regional, Heidi spent the majority of her career in the Taunton Public School System in a variety of roles, including high school English teacher, English language arts curriculum supervisor, and elementary school principal. Heidi also serves as a visiting lecturer here at BSU and has presented a number of professional trainings throughout her career. So we are very, very thankful to have two Bridgewater State alum on campus to discuss their perspective on the hiring process in education. So I have a series of questions that I think might be good, but I definitely want to give time for you as the audience to ask questions and get, you know, what you're most interested in learning out there. So I'm going to start, and feel free, whoever would like to begin, with some of these questions. My first question is if you can describe what the hiring process is within your school system.
Sure. So in New Bedford, we post all the jobs on School Spring. And we ask the applicants to apply through School Spring. You can upload your resume, or you can just put your resume in manually into School Spring. The hiring principal then reaches out and contacts you, come in for an interview. We do require a model lesson. I always have the candidates that I'm interviewing. That's usually done in like the second round. And I always make sure the candidate knows the diversity in the class, the subject matter, and I usually give the topic something that the students have already learned, so that the candidate isn't sort of struggling with, you know, building bridges and things like that, scaffolding too much. So that's the process in New Bedford. And once you're appointed, then you head down to Human Capital Services office, and you fill out your paperwork, do your query, things like that. Okay? It's probably similar.
Yeah, it's very similar at Southeastern Regional. We start from School Spring. We take all of our resumes from there. We look through them. We usually choose for one position anywhere from 5 to 8 candidates to interview in person. Once we interview in person, we choose 2 or 3 people to do a model lesson. That's usually a lesson that could be anywhere from 15 to 30 minutes long. Sometimes we do it with students. Other times it's with the department, the other teachers in the department, let's say the math department or the English department, whatever the job is. And the purpose of our model lessons isn't necessarily to showcase content knowledge. So if you're a math teacher, we don't need to see that you know calculus. We want you to showcase your teaching strategies. So, for example, we walk them to the room, they know what our classrooms look like before they do a model lesson, and they see that we have a smart board, and every kid has a Chromebook. If somebody comes in and does not use a lot of tools that we have and showcase what they have, they might not be in an advantage. Once we do the model lessons, not only do we as administrators give feedback, the teachers or students give feedback on the lessons, and then we make our selection from there. And same process, then it goes to human resources, query checks, things like that.
And can I just ask a follow-up? Roughly how long does that process take from maybe that initial, whether it's the first round interview through the final completion?
It's quick. I try and have about a 2 to 3 week turnaround.
Oh, great.
Yeah, just to get it done. You really want to make sure you're hiring, you know, the best folks and you get that done quickly. So, yeah, what about you?
Yeah, I would say it's a pretty quick turnaround, maybe 2 to 3 weeks, but it depends on the season. So if we know we have an anticipated opening due to a leave, that might take a little longer because it isn't something urgent that we have to fill this minute. But I would say in around April is when hiring season starts for the next year, and those are quick hires that happen. And then again, the month of August, when there's sort of shifting due to a domino effect in all different school districts, then there's another sort of round of hires, I'd say.
That's great. So that, we talked a little bit about the hiring timeline earlier, and it does reflect sort of what you mentioned, so that's very helpful to hear. I'm curious if you could tell us roughly how many teacher openings you have per year, and also how many applicants you typically get per position.
I don't know if I can really answer that clearly. We have, I think this past year we had, you know, over 200 because of retirements. And as far as applicants, I can't speak to that. I'm not, but I think they get, you know, anywhere double to triple that. So
that 200 is for the district?
Yes,
and
yes.
Then, yeah.
In about my school, I only had 2 to 3 openings with regards to whether someone retired or was a non-renewal, so. Mm-hmm.
But lots of applicants.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I can talk about different levels. When I was an elementary school principal, we would typically have 1, maybe 2 positions open per year due to retirements or people moving to different positions. And for elementary school positions, we would have hundreds of applicants. We always struggled with people who were licensed in the early childhood, so that the K to 2. So that was really, really something we looked for. Tons of elementary school applicants. I heard her mentioning earlier about make sure your license is on top and if you speak another language. Those things at the top of an elementary school or resume is crucial because we would get so many, we actually would print them from school spring and look through them. At the high school level, so 9 through 12, last year at my school, we hired 3 new math teachers. There were new positions because our school's expanding, and I think a lot of schools are right now serving more students, especially vocational schools. So we had 3 new math teachers, 1 new history teacher, 1 new special education teacher, and several new paraprofessionals. And that's one school, we have about 1,400 students. We also hired a physics teacher. For sciences, we don't have a lot of applicants at all for physics or chemistry. If anyone has a physics or chemistry license, put it on the top of your resume. Everyone will fight over you. I'll give you my card. Call me. That is absolutely something that's really urgent. For mathematics, for the 3 positions we had about 25 applicants. The ones that we focused on were the ones who had initial licenses with student teaching experiences. Some of them had preliminary licenses, which means they didn't have that experience of student teaching. And for history, when we do have a history opening, we have hundreds of applicants. For history openings, we have hundreds of applicants. The past few history teachers we've hired have either been student teachers who have basically been on a job interview, you know, student teaching is a job interview for those that full semester. We also hired someone who did student teaching and has a JD. We also have a history teacher with a PhD who was a visiting lecturer at several other colleges and wanted to come to the high school. It's very, very competitive with history. And English, even though it's not quite as competitive as history, it's close. So for those subjects, we look for people with 2 licenses, with things that would help us at our school with our schedule and be more beneficial to our kids.
So that you spoke a little bit to this, but obviously when there's hundreds of applicants and maybe a handful of positions, what are some additional things that students can do to set themselves apart? Obviously the dual licensure, but other pieces that really would catch your eye as a hiring
process?
I know in the cover letter, if, you know, it's sometimes when you're applying on School Spring, it's sort of mundane and routine and you're just kind of clicking. But if you're really interested in a particular position or a particular district, make sure you tailor that cover letter to the position and note if it's an urban district, you know, note any urban experience that you've had, and even note other activities with, you know, in an urban setting that you've had. That will catch people's eyes. Definitely in the cover letter, if you can note, and keep the cover letter sort of succinct. You know, I've read like 2-page cover letters and I was like, oh boy, that was kind of torturous and I didn't get much out of it. So, you know, make sure you're stating what you need to state in that cover letter. But also if you speak another language, and what you think you can bring to the school and offer from the clubs that you've been in at the university and things like that. Those all are things that count because ultimately, we want to hire, you know, the best candidate that wants to be at our school and that enjoys being around children for long durations of time.
And I would say the same thing. Anything that's crucial would be your license information, whether you speak another language. Those types of things need to be at the top, near, here's my phone number, I can do these things. I've looked at some resumes that it does say licensed, but it doesn't say what level or what field. So you need to actually write licensed in elementary education, grades blank through blank, initial, preliminary. And even though you could write that you've passed the teacher's test, it's more beneficial to write anticipated certification date and write that date. Because we don't want to have to figure out if you have a license or not, and if there are hundreds of applicants, we're probably not going to spend that time to figure it out. If any of you have been orientation leaders or in leadership tour guides, positions like that at your school, someone who we know likes to be at school and enjoys being a part of a community, that's something that sets you out for sure. Somebody mentioned earlier that she's a coach. That's a big deal. We definitely want to know that because we know you've had experience with students and with managing groups of kids. Something that used to be traditional on resumes is that you would put your education first. Just here's my degree right away. If you write your license number, if we see that you have a teacher's license, we know you have a degree. We want to see your experience first thing. So you might want to save that for later when we're going through all these resumes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm also curious if you can talk a little bit about whether or not you appreciate students who try to network with you. So in general hiring and other majors and things, we encourage students to reach out to contacts and network with companies and professionals. Is there a preferred method within sort of the school system that works well? You know, so if somebody is interested in being a high school English teacher, are they able to kind of set up informational interviews, or are there, you know, professional ways for them to do that beyond just applying directly?
That's a really good question.
Well, I take that. Sure. At my school, we're so close to Bridgewater that we have a lot of people come in and do observation hours there. So I bring the people to the classrooms. So that's a good way to network, just your observation hours. Make sure they know who you are. Make sure you introduce yourself. Tell them how much you love their school. Make sure that you're a smiling face that's happy to be in the school. And then when it comes time for you to have that conversation, when you come in to do some observation hours, you can say, hey. Well, maybe not hey, but hello. Yeah. I'm about to start applying for jobs, and I was wondering if you had 5 minutes so I could pick your brain. That's a way to do it. Administrators and teachers are very busy. Mm-hmm. And how we do observation hours for Bridgewater at my school is we don't take 9,000 emails and contacts and this and that. If you come to the building between 7:15 and 7:30, you have your ID swiped by our scanner, so we make sure that it's safe to have you in the building. You get a visitor's tag, and we allow you to be with a staff member for observation. That's the only way we can actually manage having this many observers from Bridgewater, is because if we did it any other way, it would interfere with teaching. So you don't want to interfere with somebody's school day. You want to make sure they know you understand that students and the school is a priority. I am a huge fan of a personal email, maybe with a link to a website or whatever information you want to dazzle the school with your great volleyball statistics, I don't know, whatever it happens to be. But the email should, like she mentioned, be customized so that it isn't, even if you are sending mass emails to 9,000 schools, I want to feel special, like you care about me and my school, and my school is the place you want to be. I'm going to say, wow, this person really wants to be at this school. The person spelled my name right and all the words in the email, and my superintendent's name, and that's a big deal. And those little things, those are helpful and will help you network in, so that if all of a sudden, oh my gosh, I need to fill a position suddenly that I wasn't anticipating, we don't have time to say, let me look through 200. We have to get somebody in a room quickly. Sometimes we might say, ooh, let me pull. Who was that nice person who shared with me this wonderful online portfolio? Who's that person? Let's seek that person out and see if they're looking for employment as we go through this process. Those kinds of things help.
So it sounds like getting contact and kind of face-to-face is still something that's very important today.
Absolutely.
I've heard, too, that substitute teaching is obviously an excellent way to get into a district. Can you speak a little to that as to, you know, maybe candidates that you've known who came right out of college with their degree and their license but couldn't get a full-time position, so they subbed, you know, a long-term sub or something, then that landed them into their next role. Is that a common thing? That
is a common thing. I was actually going to say subbing would be a great route to networking. It's sometimes you know, a difficult position to put yourself in because you're stepping into someone else's classroom. You might only be there for a day. I know at my school we treat our substitutes as visitors to our school, and just like at home, how do you treat the visitors in your home? So, you know, it's not what you've seen if you've never subbed before, sort of in movies where kids are, you know, hanging from the ceiling. But you know, it's very structured, and the kids respect that they're visitors here to the school, and our school is our home. But that's a great opportunity. Another piece is the long-term subs. I have three women in my building right now that are pregnant. So I have one filled going out in November, and I'll have two more in the spring. So those sometimes aren't posted. Sometimes they are, sometimes they're not, but this one was posted on School Spring. And the other piece is, I just want to put out there, in New Bedford we have building substitutes in the building, and my human resources supervisor asked me to say that New Bedford still has a number of building substitutes. That's a great position to sort of put yourself in. You're based at one building, and then you get to know the staff and the students, and then you're assigned when people are out. In my particular building, my staff has great attendance, so my building sub is actually a quasi-interventionist. He'll sort of go into classrooms and, you know, take a group of students to work on fluency and things like that. And then one other piece is if you're interested in sort of, you know, getting your foot in the door and there's not too much out there at this point, paraprofessional positions is a great stepping stone. A lot of those positions, especially mid-year, they do sort of pop up for one reason or another. And, you know, the pay isn't so great, but it allows you to be in a building, to be working right next to or right with a group of teachers that are licensed, and that you can get some really good experience from and really great references. And you can decide if you want to stay in that district. I know I hired two paraprofessionals, one from my school, one from another, who got their license all set after last year. So that was an easy push right in. So.
So the substitute teaching, absolutely a wonderful way in, but I would encourage you to look for paraprofessional jobs mm-hmm. if you need to be employed. I get worried sometimes. We also take a lot of student teachers at my school, and many of them are holding out and don't apply for or take paraprofessional jobs because they're waiting to be a full-time teacher. If you are in a school district, like she said, going into a school every single day, when a position opens up, you are the front runner because you're already there living an interview every day. So if you have an opportunity to be full-time in a school, that will get your foot in the door, even if you're if your history or English or anything like that. Our paraprofessionals, and I want to say last year, I don't even know how many we hired. I would say we hired 10 or more. Most of our paraprofessionals are licensed teachers in history or English. And they are applying for teaching jobs, of course, but they are sort of waiting in the wings at our school and will be, of course, invited to go through the process when a job opens up. But we know them. We know their teaching style. We know their relationships with students. And they can be coaches. They can teach in our after-school programs. And as far as opportunities go, a building sub where you're there every day or a paraprofessional, which is a teacher assistant, if you don't know what that is, those two really are resume builders more so than somebody who says, I need to work every day, so I'm going to be a sub at Oliver Ames, then Brockton High today, then another school tomorrow, and you sort of jump around to buildings. You might make more money in the short term, but long term, it is a little bit more difficult to get your foot in the door.
So that's a very important note, because most of the students in the room are December graduates. So they'll be graduating kind of halfway through the academic year. Mm-hmm. So if you can be looking for those in addition to obviously any full-time positions, widening your net, hopefully you'll have more opportunities when that position does become available. So that's very helpful. My next question is if you can talk a little bit about some of the typical interview questions you ask, some of the really interesting ones that maybe students wouldn't think to prepare for.
So I usually ask just very open-ended questions, probably ones that you've seen, whether you've Googled them or you've gotten handouts from, because I like to give the candidate an opportunity to really showcase themselves and to, you know, so I can see, you know, what's important to them. A very typical one is, you know, what's something that you're very proud of when you worked with students or children. That allows me to see, you know, how the things they have listed on their resume sort of comes to life. I also ask, you know, what's a challenging situation you've had in the past, whether you've been in a classroom or whether you've been working with students in a camp or what have you, because I think it's important because we all face, you know, difficult, challenging situations every single day. I had several this morning, but so Amanda laughs. I have one of my student teachers here, so you know, and it's interesting for the interviewer to see the candidate, you know, their ability to just sort of say, this happened, this is how I troubleshot it, and this is how it was resolved. So that's a big one that I ask, and then you know, some of the typical things about. I also ask a very pointed question about technology use, like Heidi was saying, you know, your comfort level with technology, you know, your willingness to go and get trained in the city and things like that. So very simple, you know, questions. I don't know if you want to be more specific.
Yeah, well, so it's funny to hear that because my two most common questions are very similar. I usually look at an experience on the resume and ask the candidate to tell me about their experience at whatever school or at student mm-hmm. teaching and let them talk at first. And what I listen for is the storytelling. So is the story I, and then I, and then me, or is it my students? My students could. My students. My team. So it's very telling when you should practice that. How are you going to talk about these experiences you had and make sure that they are student-focused? And I think sometimes, you know, people are nervous. They might not have heard a question like that. And we do want to hear about you, but really we want to hear about you in relation to your students. And the second question that I always ask is, tell me about the worst thing that has happened to you in a classroom. Mm-hmm. What was it? How did you handle it? And what, if anything, would you do differently? So that's always a very telling question too, because if somebody says the worst thing that ever happened during my experience is the student once didn't do his homework, and I was heartbroken. Oh, okay. So that, it's okay to say, once I was in a classroom and this student told me to, I don't know, jump out a window or something. This student was mean to me and said blah, blah, blah. Give a real world example of something you dealt with. And it's okay to say, I was shocked. And I had to calm down and I had to de-escalate the situation. And here's how I changed it. And then I called the parent. And I appreciate people giving those real life moments that teachers have all day long, every year, no matter how long you've been teaching, those things that you weren't prepared for. And when somebody is honest with that, what that tells me is that when one of those moments happens in a classroom, I know that that person is going to feel comfortable saying to me, oh, Heidi, this just happened. Let me help. Can we talk it out? Let's talk about, make a plan what to do so we can help this kid. Somebody who is honest about those experiences that are difficult, that is somebody who I want at my school. Somebody who doesn't want to share those things and thinks if they had those experiences, they're not a good teacher, or I would think they're not a good teacher, that's not a good starting point. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, that's very helpful the way you framed that and telling the story like that. I'm wondering if you could share your thoughts on professional clothing and wearing potentially a suit to an interview. Both of you are dressed very professionally with nice blazers on. And I think sometimes our students feel like they may not have to, because on a typical basis you might get to wear khakis or more casual clothing. But for the interview, you know, we recommend they dress up. So I wonder if you could talk about that and your perception when the candidate walks in.
Sure. I think business casual is a good rule of thumb to use. I definitely think I've had candidates come in full suits and ties, and then I've had people come in a sweatshirt. So there's definitely that, that difference there, what the job value is. And I understand people might be coming from work and things like that. I think, be comfortable, be yourself, but also think about that this is the first time, you're meeting these people and you want to come to work there. I would say business casual with a suit, and if you're a male candidate, you might not want to wear a tie. Shirt and trousers is fine. So I did have someone come in shorts last year, and they were very short. Very inappropriate. So you might want to just judge that on your own. But you're definitely, I think, having worked in the non-education field as well for several years, I always sort of, lean on the side of more professional dressing rather than less is the best rule of thumb.
So I agree. I can give you a couple examples of people who I remember interviewing who were not hired. Even though this one person came in, this was quite a few years ago, it was, I don't remember what subject, but it was for a high school position, and the candidate wasn't a full suit, but the suit was white with colorful stripes all over the whole thing, and I said, oh my gosh. It was kind of shocking to see. It wasn't a conservative suit, and my school is not conservative, let me tell you. I do not have a conservative school, but that was just sort of like, I wonder what, within this person's judgment, thought this would be the right way to present himself. Another time, I really appreciated the effort of this person. They came in a polo shirt, a collared polo shirt, which is fine. But how my office is positioned, I have some windows in it, and the visitor parking is right in front of it, and the person stepped outside of the car, and he changed outside of my window, right there. And I said, please tell me that's not the person person? Oh, and it was. Okay. So I appreciated the effort, but there must have been somewhere. There's Dunkin' Donuts down the street. Or, you know, so you've got to be self-aware. And then we start the interview, and hello, this is awkward. So anything that might make the interviewer uncomfortable, you want to be aware of that, because we're, you know, human beings are human beings. So I've had a physics teacher come in with a suit coat and a Star Wars t-shirt underneath, and he's the hip science teacher and dazzled us, and okay, that's fine. But if you are somebody who's competing against hundreds of people, you don't want to be remembered for the outfit you had on. You want to be remembered for your great interview and great answers. And that's it.
Yeah, that's definitely helpful. I think the key thing is, like you just said, you don't want to distract them from what you're saying based on what you're wearing. Mm-hmm. So you can look nice, but focus on the content of yourself and then your personality, of course. So that's definitely helpful. I'm wondering if you can share maybe some specific skill sets in the classroom that are very valuable today, whether it's assessment or experience with, you know, inclusive classrooms and special education, or, you know, some specific kind of teacher qualities that would stand out. And maybe some of those are things you might observe more in the model lesson, but certain things that would really draw you in to a teacher.
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Teachers who clearly love kids, teachers who respect students. Those are crucial for my school. It's evident sometimes in the storytelling during the interview, when a person maybe has a classroom with lots of punitive, this has to happen if this happens, and power struggles. Somebody who appreciates the relationship between a student and a teacher, builds that mutual respect, and can communicate that and convey that during the interview and during the model lesson, that's really, really important. So my school, we're right up the street in Easton. It's a very diverse population, and I'm very sensitive to how people speak about my students. And if I even have an inkling that someone doesn't understand that all students count, that does not go well in the interview. So a question I sometimes ask, we're in Easton, but most of our students are from Brockton. And at an interview, when somebody says to me, so you're in Easton, but most of your students are from Brockton? Huh? I want to know why that matters. That is a shocking question. Now, if someone says, I'm excited to work at your school because you have kids from so many different places, and that sounds great, that person I like to hear about. But those, knowing that it doesn't matter which students are in front of you, you teach them all, and you treat everybody with the same respect, that's crucial.
I would echo what Heidi said, especially about the diverse populations and, you know, students living, you know, with some severe poverty issues and taking those things into consideration. However, with regards to skills, you know, in an urban school, there are many, like in many schools, there are many special education populations. And I see it in younger teachers as well, and more veteran teachers. Some folks aren't comfortable with having like that co-teaching model with a special educator involved in the class. So I, you know, look for, you know, who have you collaborated with in your student teaching practices and your practicums, to find out if they're comfortable, you know, teaching side by side, if they're comfortable, you know, sharing ideas with colleagues. So definitely that teacher collaboration, co-teaching model. I noted technology before, but I just want to fine-tune it that we're thankful we have, we don't have a whole lot of technology at my school, but we have a computer lab and two iPad carts, and I'm pushing to get more. And the teachers all have desktops, four or five in each classroom. However, you know, with the iPad carts, the kids see them two or three times a week, but what are they doing with them? So how comfortable are you with finding apps, using the apps in class, and what's the accountability for the students with that? So that's something, you know, have you had that experience in your student teaching? Amanda is actually at my school, and the Dean of Education comes to my school once a month and has given this job of finding educational apps to poor Amanda. I don't know how that all happened. I got pulled off to something else. The next thing I know, the Dean is up in Amanda's class. And I went, oh my, I wonder what's going on. But you know, so that technology, but how you use it, how you tie it to science, you know, what's that accountability piece? And if you've had experience, and if you haven't had experience, just sort of brainstorming to say, you know, this is how I think I'd use it. And then the other piece is we can teach assessment, you know, how to assess the assessments that students take in class, but what do you do with that data? So, and you know, you might have had experiences in your student teaching, but I definitely know you've had them in your education classes here, but you know, you can kind of speak to that. You know, I would use data to do X, Y, and Z, although I haven't had any direct experience. This is what I've been taught, this is what I've read about, I have friends that do this. You know, so really how you use data or how you would anticipate using data. Those are really big pieces. Because we can teach you how to assess DIBELS, we can teach you how to, you know, score, you know, whether it's a fluency piece or another graded assessment, but it's really how you use it, so.
I'd like to echo that. So there's so many of those things, you're probably hearing data and this and that. We can, as a school system or as an individual school, teach you how to do so many of those things. And as long as you're willing to learn those things, the technology, make connections, and you show your positivity towards that, schools will know you're ready to learn. But there are those interpersonal things that we have, that we need you to be skilled at already before you come. That's why coaching and things like that, working with everybody, that's crucial. And that's those kinds of skills, once you're in a classroom on your own, it's very difficult for us to help teach those interpersonal skills. That's hard. But we can say, okay, let's go to a training on data and help impact the classroom, and you have this background. And I think most of you, during your observation hours, observing is one type of experience, but when you are actually the person in the room responsible for all the interactions in the room, that's a tall tale. That's hard to do.
Well, we've hit a number of key things that I think were very helpful for the students, but I do want to open it up to your questions. I find a lot of times that's where we get a lot of really good content as well. So I'd like to open it up to the audience and hear what questions you have for our panelists. And don't be shy.
You had said that one thing that you ask is to talk about something that happened in the classroom, like a negative thing with a student. But what about with teachers? Like, would that be something that
definitely,
you about
definitely,
how you handle
yep,
the situation?
Definitely, okay. Yep, because those are. You know, those are situations that are going to come up because you'll be on a grade level team. You might have a difference of opinion. I had a newer teacher come to me last year. She was on a grade level team with two other more veteran teachers, and she basically was trying to tell me, you know, they're not listening to me. And I said, well, you're an equal member of that team. How are they perceiving you? I mean, I went and sat with her, but I tried to coach her that way as well. But those are definitely things that come up. Yeah.
I would also say you don't want to say this was a negative experience. Necessarily. Be careful about that. But
yeah.
Talk about what you learned from it. Focus
yeah.
on
challenging.
That. Yeah.
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 Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are you looking for portfolios? Like an online portfolio, a notebook, a blog? Like, what do you like portfolios or no?
So are they all required to make a portfolio?
No.
I've had some people mention it to me, some people haven't, and so they're like, oh, we made one, we didn't make one, so I'm not sure, because they've never mentioned it.
Okay. I have my notes here from my human resources director, and she basically said we do not look at portfolios, but we do require the model lesson in front of the class. However, I've had folks bring me portfolios, and I definitely take the time to look through them, and I always ask them one or two questions about, you know, why did you include this or whatnot. I love Heidi's idea of a link you know, in an email, a follow-up email from the candidate or what have you, with a link to note that. I think that's really neat, you know, and I think that would be great advice. But I think you're going to see in the school spring ads if a portfolio is required or not. And when you're applying, if you apply online, then you can always do a follow-up to the school and say, you know, should I bring this a portfolio to the interview? Or if the principal contacts you by email, you can ask that, should I bring a portfolio? Okay?
I'm just curious, I want to ask something to everybody. Have any of you been to an interview or have a friend who was required to bring one? Can you give me a thumbs up if you, so that's like maybe
one or two.
One person?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if I'm interviewing 10 people and each shows up with a binder like this of paper, I'm going to be honest, I'm not going to look through every sheet of the binders like this. But if you have a wonderful interview, or if you even reach out to the person to ask for an interview and say, do you have my resume, and you attach a link to an online portfolio or a blog or whatever it is that you want to represent yourself, I frequently will look at those, and those do get my attention as somebody who works with teachers, because they're quick and easy access. And when I'm looking at my email later after the school day is over and I'm going through, I will actually have the time to look through whatever it is that you've shared. And in the classes that I teach here at Bridgewater, I'm encouraging students to make I'm sure you've done this in some of your classes. You've made an educational philosophy, and you've maybe made your own personal mission statement, or you have an objective for your job. So if you have those things linked to something online, that's much more likely that it will get noticed, and people will look at it.
Did you have a question? I have not made a LinkedIn profile yet, but do you find that you use them? Do you look for things on LinkedIn?
I use SchoolSpring only.
Okay.
SchoolSpring directly from there. And then also when you come to the in-person interview, I recommend, and I don't know if you do too, bring a hard copy of your resume so that somebody can have it right in front of them and take notes on it. I think LinkedIn is nice to have. That way, when you're in a school system, people will stay connected and you'll know about other experiences. But my school district does not use that to recruit teachers.
In New Bedford, they've actually started last year. They were sort of a requirement that all the principals have a LinkedIn. Now some of the teachers are, some of the new grads. I haven't yet. I just don't like being told what to do sometimes. So, I think that's definitely something that's, you know, up and coming, and I think you're wise to do it. So, yeah.
Are you over here?
Is the interview process the same for like a general ed versus a special ed as far as like the model lesson?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You do the same thing?
Yes. Yep. I had a group of third graders last year. Some of them are Amanda's students now in fourth grade, and they were I was hiring for two ESL positions, and they were my ESL committee. You know, I called them that, and the teachers knew, you know, I would schedule all my interviews in the afternoon, and a couple of times a week, you know, I grabbed them with the candidate, you know, walked them down, and they were great. You know, it was like seven or eight of them, and they knew exactly what to do. So it was a mixed group, and I would tell the candidate that ahead of time, you know, and when she was or he was coming in for the second interview, and I would give them sort of a little profile on each student, their levels and things like that. But it's definitely, you definitely need to see a model lesson. Like Heidi said, we definitely structure, you know, what, you know, give you the background. So it's not just you come in, oh, it was a great interview, let's do a model lesson. No, you know, that would be unnerving to anyone, so. Yeah.
When you have candidates come in for a model lesson, do you usually give them free range on what subject they're going to teach with elementary, or do you just say, you're going to teach math? Here you go.
I like I said earlier, I usually try and give them a topic that the kids have already learned. So it's already been covered. I hate that word covered, but it's already been taught in the curriculum, you know, within the last month or two. So it's fresh in the students' minds. And I usually give them some guidance because I don't want them teaching the students something new and having something, you know, come up that the students couldn't have anticipated or a misconception.
We more often do our mini lessons, or whatever you want to call them, with adults pretending to be high school students. Mm. And we will say to a candidate, teach whatever you would like, but we give them perimeters. You need to tell us who we are. Or do you want us to be ninth grade students? Do you want us to be 10th grade students? And we emphasize that we want you to showcase your teaching, not your content. So you don't need to prove to us that you know math if you're a math major and you're a licensed math teacher. But you do need to show us how you will relate to everybody in the room, what tools you'll use if you have 15 minutes. And she had mentioned the skills that people need, using technology and using data. If you do a mini lesson, that is a time you can show that you're aware of those things and how you would implement it during your lesson. That's a great time to do it.
When you're sifting through a lot of resumes, how much do things like college honors and like international experiences factor into your decisions?
For me, it counts a lot. It's definitely, it draws your eye to that. When you've gone abroad, I lived abroad several times, and it shows that you're adaptable, and that you have that experience if you speak another language. And college honors, I think, is huge. You've put the time in, you've made the effort, you're committed. I think it shows a lot about your character.
I agree with that, but I think for those of you who haven't traveled abroad or, you can't decide to be an honor student the last semester of your senior year, for those of you who need to make sure you get attention too for the good things you've done, if you have been connected to and plugged into your campus, that I think counts just as much as somebody who's well-traveled and, it all depends on your personal experience. If you don't have anything to list at all, that is something you want to consider for your last semester, even while you're student teaching. What can you do? I think somebody mentioned CPDC, or what can you do to connect? And that's important. And if you do speak another language, I know I said this 20 times already, absolutely put that right at the top of your resume.
So I know you guys look on School Spring for resumes and cover letters. Do you recommend going to the school to drop off a copy as well? Because that's been recommended to me before. I don't know.
It's in New Bedford. It's really just schools. We just use School Spring. I was in Brockton for a long time, and we just use School Spring as well. However, we did have several candidates come in with hard copies to drop off. It wasn't disregarded, but I would, if you're not using School Spring, you should, it's detrimental, I think. If you're just submitting the paper, then you might be overlooked. But if you do both, I think that's what you're kind of alluding to, too, that would be fine. I don't think it's necessary,
okay.
So.
Yeah, I don't think it's necessary, but I think when you get an interview, show up with paper in hand.
Yeah.
I think and somebody mentioned this earlier, if you put in an application and apply for a job on School Spring, if you then later find out who were the people who may interview you and say, I just wanted to confirm that my resume was received, I look forward to meeting or talking to or contributing to your school district, and then you have a link to some information, whether it be your LinkedIn or some profile, that would be, I think, sort of the equivalent of standing and waiting and handing in it.
Down the road, when you do get a job and you are accepted back for an interview, nowadays, is it more acceptable to handwrite a letter, thank you letter, or put it in an email? That's been a good question.
That's a good question.
That is a good question. I have a husband who's a human resources manager at one of the local hospitals, and he always likes a handwritten for some reason, although I don't think he's ever written a handwritten in his life. But for me, I'll be honest, it's either email or a handwritten. You should do a thank you letter, especially if it's a job you want. So either handwritten or email, and it's very nice to get. The benefit with the email is the person's going to get it the next day or the day after. The handwritten, it might take a couple of days, you know, but I just think it's very, you should do it whatever way you're comfortable with, but electronically might get there quicker, so.
Or maybe that might be something that you drop off, just drop off a note with somebody's secretary,
that's true.
A thank you note. I know when I get a handwritten thank you note, it always surprises me. And isn't that so nice? You know, I really have really good impressions of people who give the handwritten note. The emails depend. It's hard for me to remember who everybody is sometimes. So when I get that little envelope with somebody's address, actual, I'll say, oh, it's the person from New Bedford. Oh, it's the person from wherever, and I'll remember the person more easily. But I'm not, when someone sends a thank you email, I'm not disappointed and say, oh, they should have written a note on the station or not.
No.
Not at all.
You said substitute teaching is a good way to get your foot in the door, but to be a professional is a better way. Is that something like anyone can do, or do you need like certain certifications to become a professional?
No, paraprofessional, if you have a college degree, you're definitely qualified. Those that do not have a college degree, but some paraprofessionals have been in it for several years, so they've been sort of grandfathered in. Usually it's with some college credits.
42 credits, 42 college credits, or you need an associate's degree or higher to be a highly qualified paraprofessional.
And then, like I mentioned, in New Bedford, we recently put in building substitutes, and I know there's several positions available at elementaries and middle schools now for those mid-year. So I actually have a list of what's available. They have shortages right now still with some special ed positions, ESL, science, math, and technology. And then they have, for just general openings, they have about a dozen positions, just upper elementary, things like that. And then the building subs, my director noted that there's they still have openings throughout the district for building substitutes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
As far as most of us in the room, I think, are in an SEL endorsement class.
Mm, good.
Should that be put on our cover letter, or where should that be? Or that should be expected now? Because
it's expected.
It's expected.
Oh, yeah.
If you have a license, we know you've done that.
Okay. But should that be part of anywhere on the resume or anything?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah, okay. Definitely. I think in School Spring, when you're plugging your data in, it actually, there's a place now for SEL endorsement, I think.
There may be. I personally don't, if I see that you've gone, just because I know Bridgewater and I know UMass Dartmouth, and I know if you have a teaching license, that's a part of it. But a lot of people who maybe as
coming
recently
back.
As 3 years ago,
yeah.
right, may not have it. So we do ask that question.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're a recent grad, hopefully the people will know that you've done those things.
We have about 5 more minutes, so we have time for a few more questions.
Are you more likely to hire someone with their bachelor's or a master's? So I know I've heard from certain principals that they don't want to pay me because I have master's, but other ones want to, so.
I've never been told that. I've been told to hire the best candidate.
Okay.
So both in New Bedford and in Brockton. So, yeah.
So I can say I've been, as I told you, we hired people with PhDs at my school. We hire the best candidate, but I am absolutely positive that if you have a master's degree with no teaching experience, it is more difficult to get a job because you're more expensive with no experience. So the expectation is that if we're paying you this certain amount, you will be able to handle your classes and be well-versed in your content and be able to work with all different types of students, all different levels of students. Whereas if somebody comes out of college and you have a bachelor's degree, your student teaching experience, you would come to us as a step one, level one. And so that means, okay, I understand the support that this person is going to need because they've only had that one experience. The expectation is there. When we hire somebody with a PhD who goes all the way to the top of the pay scale, the expectation is higher. So that is something to be aware of. So if you do have a master's degree, or if any of you are doing the program where you can go directly into your master's, make sure your resume is heavy with your experience with students, with all types of students.
Do you find that you look more at students' resumes who are dual licensed as opposed to just elementary ed or just college?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I've heard that it's very difficult nowadays if you're up against people with like dual licensures.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
So something that, you know, how many of you are elementary majors in the room? Okay, so a lot of you. So if you're an elementary major, you have a double major. So some of you might have English, or you might have math, or you might have some, whatever your content major is. Something you could do to add an additional license, which would be useful for a district like New Bedford, that's K-12, is if I'm a math major, I'll go take the math subject matter test for high school, which counts for both my high school math license and my middle school math license. Mm-hmm. So now I'm an elementary school teacher who passed the math teacher's test, and I have two extra licenses. So now I'm licensed K-12. Mm-hmm. So that means I could get in the door as maybe a middle school math teacher, mm-hmm. and then I could transfer when an elementary school position opens up. So that's something a lot of people don't realize, that with a bachelor's degree and the teacher's test, you can add licenses and make yourself more marketable. Do you understand what I mean by that? Yes? Okay. All right. Thank you. Just want to make sure.
Maybe one or two more questions?
Actually, talking about the drugs for success, and you mentioning their essentials.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Just thinking.
Yeah, so Blair just brought up a really great program that we have on campus. I know we talked a lot about professional attire and going to interviews professionally dressed. Bridgewater has this new program called Bare Essentials, and what it is it's a closet of gently used and donated suits and professional clothing. So if you don't have a suit at home or you don't really have a lot of professional attire, you can actually go to the internship program office, literally walk in, and they have a closet full of beautiful clothes that have been donated from professors, faculty, alumni, staff, and you can go through the closet and pick something out, and it's yours to keep. You don't have to return it. It's literally yours to wear to an interview, to wear to a career fair, or whatever it might be. So we did want to mention that because it's a great opportunity for students who might not have the means in this moment to go out and buy a new blazer, to go out and buy new dress pants. So definitely check that out. Again, it's through the internship program office. If you want more details, you can come up and ask Blair or I. So how about maybe one more question before we wrap up? Any burning questions? Okay, so instead of that, if you have any final words of advice for how these students can be successful in their job hunt.
I was a January candidate, a January graduate, so I was a candidate mid-year. I only had a master's degree. Well, I had a master's degree, no experience. But I sold myself on the student experiences that I had in my classes. I have a MED from BU in English as a second language. Every single class at BU in that program, they make you be in a class, whether you're looking at syntax or phonology or whatever. You know, you're with students in every single class. That's how I sold myself. I really used that experience because I didn't have any prior teaching experience. You know, take what you've got and make the best of it, because you all probably have something really special to offer, because Bridgewater graduates really, you know, well-prepared candidates. So I can attest to that with my student teacher in the building, so.
I guess I'd like to echo the same things. We love having Bridgewater student teachers at our school because we love to hire them. And students who go to Bridgewater end up with experiences and meaningful practice with students. That translates into good teaching. And we appreciate that. And you need to showcase yourself. And sometimes I remember being an undergrad 75 years ago and hearing things like, oh, make sure you do this, and make sure you do that. And I would think, oh, I didn't do that. But she's absolutely right. You need to showcase your own experiences and not worry about anybody else. Just showcase yourself.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Great. Well, we've learned a lot today. I hope that this was beneficial for everybody in the room. You can give a nice round of applause.